Okay, now I'm going to go through some of the terminology. We use lots of different terminology with level of consciousness. So we're going to talk about everything from full consciousness down to comatose. Now, if somebody is fully conscious, that should be you on a good day. Not after a big nursing school exam, but on a good day. You're alert, you're attentive, you can follow commands. If you're asleep, you would wake up pretty quickly and you would be able to follow what someone asked you to do. Once we did wake you up, you would be able to stay awake. That should be your everyday person walking through everyday life. Now, lethargic. Patients kind of drowsy, but they will awake, but not really fully. They're just kind of really sleepy, but you have to stimulate them. So they'll answer questions and follow commands, but they're just really not following you. Kind of like how you feel after walking out of a pharmacology final. That's like lethargic. Now, obtunded. Okay, this person, it's a lower level than lethargic. They're much more difficult to arouse. They kind of need constant stimulation in order to follow simple commands. They might respond verbally with one or two words, but they kind of drift back to sleep in between. Now, stuporous takes vigorous and continuous stimulation. Typically, a painful stimulus is required. So we've gone from fully awake and alert and talking to, kind of lethargic and drowsy, to obtunded, where you keep falling asleep, to stuporous requires constant stimulation that's painful. It might moan briefly, but doesn't follow commands, only responds after an attempt to withdraw from the pain. So in obtunded, you're really sleepy, you respond verbally with one or two words, but you kind of go back to sleep. Stuporous, they're not going to follow commands. What they might do in movement as far as just try to get you away, pull their hands back or do whatever if you're using painful stimulus, but they're not following commands. Now, the last one is the saddest one. It's comatose. We use that term pretty frequently. You see it on TV and all these medical shows. But when a medical person uses the word comatose, that's someone who does not respond to continuous or painful stimulation. Now, when we say painful stimulation, acceptable ways to do that in healthcare is to take the nail bed and press on it. Usually we use a pen or something hard, maybe the end of a reflex hammer, and you press on that nail bed. When you use something like a pen, not just my thumb, but if you just use a pen or the end of a hammer, that's pretty painful. I mean, go ahead and try it on yourself. Take the pen that you have around there, press on your nail bed. You'll see that it doesn't take very much pressure for you to feel it and want it to stop. If you do that to a patient who's comatose, they don't move. They might maybe reflexively move a little bit, and we'll talk about those types of reflexes, but they don't speak to you, they don't make a sound, and they don't do purposeful movement. Okay, so we've gone through five terms. I want you to pause the video for just a moment because that was a whole lot of information. Think through each one of these terms, make any notes that you think will be helpful to you, and make sure you have a beginning understanding of the difference between full consciousness and stuporous, full consciousness and lethargic. Make sure that's clear in your mind. Now, while you still have the video paused, I want you to think through a patient that you've had in clinicals. Pick which one of these five levels this patient would have been and give yourself some reasons on why you think that to support it. All right, so pause the video and we'll be back shortly. Okay, I hope you really took advantage of that opportunity to do that, because that's applying the information that you're learning. See, that's why nursing school tests are so difficult, because the questions are written on an application and an analysis type level. So the more you try and apply information you're learning as you learn it, the better it's going to be encoded in your brain, the better you're going to be able to retrieve it, which means you'll do better on your scores, and most important, take better care of your patients. Because it's critically important that you recognize the smallest neuroindentation changes in your patient. Okay, so you wanna be on top of it. Now, usually the first changes that the patient's starting to have some neural problems is their personality or behaviors will start to be a little different. They might become a little irritable. If a family member tells you, you know, something's not just quite right about my mom, my dad, my husband, my wife, listen to them, because those are the first signs that something could be going wrong. Might be a neuro problem, might be an oxygenation problem, but don't just brush off what someone who knows your patient outside of the hospital, when they tell you something is not right, listen, okay? So I want to tell you that we gave you the definitions of lethargic, but a lot of people interpret them different ways. You can see it's kind of vague a little bit, right? It's a little subjective. So if you look at the term lethargic, look at our definition. Patient is drowsy but awakens, although not fully to stimulus, will answer questions and follow commands, but slowly and inattentively. Let me tell you what is better documentation. I wrote an example down there for you because it's more useful to your other healthcare team members, your other fellow nurses, physicians, PAs, and nurse practitioners, if you give them a better description. So don't just write one word, lethargic, right? Try this. Mr. Johnson appears drowsy and will respond to verbal stimulus, but has difficulty with staying alert and keeping his eyes open. He does follow simple commands to squeeze his left hand and move his left leg, but often requires repeated instruction. Okay, look how much more helpful that is than just writing, Mr. Johnson is lethargic. Okay, this tells me when I'm the next nurse coming on, I have a much better feel for what Mr. Johnson is like, so I can replicate exactly what the nurse before me did and see if Mr. Johnson's responding in a way that's different, if it's better, or if it's worse. So don't take shortcuts in charting. These are things that will help get your patient get better care, you're a better advocate for them, and heaven forbid, if you ever had to go to court for a case, this is the kind of documentation that you want to see up on that wall in the courtroom, something that accurately describes what you observed with your patient in clear, concise, and objective language. Okay, those are three words I'd like you to write down. Clear, concise, and objective. Those are going to be your three best friends when it comes to documenting, delegating, or communicating. Clear, concise, and objective. And you'll hear me say that over and over and over again. It'll make you a better nurse, and it'll help your patients get more effective care.